It's time for Game Changers with Lisa Faulkner.
She's definitely an advocate for positive change.
She talks to people who's actually found their own niche in today's marketplace.
You're listening to Game Changers with Lisa Faulkner.
Lisa is a game changer,
and she's keeping it real. Entrepreneurs,
executives,
entertainers, ministers.
I'm gonna kick back with Lisa Faulkner for the next hour.
Cause she knows what she's talking about.
And she's got it going on.
Game Changers with Lisa Faulkner.
Hello, everybody, and thanks for joining me for another week of Game Changers with Lisa Faulkner. That's me. I'm your host, and I'm so glad you've tuned in for another week. I promise you it's going to be a good show, as we always try to bring you the best of Game Changers. Thank you for all of your continued support. Hey, guys, have you been checking in on Hurricane Harvey? Well, pretty much no way to avoid it, right? Tropical Depression Harvey, right? Oh, boy, I hope you're out there in your prayers, in donations, in efforts and thoughts and whatever you can do, making a difference with this Hurricane Harvey. It's not over. It looked like things were getting a little better this time last weekend, but the death toll has risen as this thing has continued to affect the Houston area and surrounding areas. So please just continue to pray for those people. And I know that there are boots on the ground. There are all types of efforts on the ground to rescue the evacuees and get people to higher ground, safer ground. And just let's just ignore and pray for all of the negative news that's going on and the negative talk about, you know, who's not doing their part, who's not responding correctly, who's not doing this or that. Because at this time, we really, really need to just focus on, you know, prayers and just the restoration of Houston and the Texas area and restoration for those people and their family and their lives and just coming back from this great devastation. So let's keep our minds and our hearts clear and our prayers focused on those people. I know that all of you good game changers are doing that. I love y'all so much, and I thank you for your continued support and listening to the show. Hey, guys, I know you're listening live right now on WAEC Love 860. Thank you for tuning in. If you have to keep moving this hour, you can tune in on your radio apps. That's iHeart, TuneIn, or iRadio Now. You can look up WAEC Love 860 on either of those radio apps and continue to listen to us for this entire hour. So you can listen online as well at Love 860. And you know what? If you miss the show, then you can catch the show anytime you want, because Game Changers is now a podcast that you can subscribe to on either iHeartRadio or iTunes. So head on over to either iHeartRadio or iTunes and subscribe to the podcast. You know, Game Changers is only able to be on either of those both of those networks, because it has its own podcast page. I rarely tell you about, but you can get to the Game Changers podcast page directly as well. So you can just also always go to Game Changers W for with, but if you're looking for it online, that's Game Changers W, Lisa Faulkner, .libsyn.com. And there you'll find the Game Changers with Lisa Faulkner podcast there as well. And you can just scroll through all of the great social media happenings and the podcast, the shows there as well. So, you know, there's just never a reason not to stay connected. Love it when you stay connected. Speaking of staying connected, follow me on Facebook, guys, Lisa M. Faulkner, LinkedIn, Lisa Faulkner, Twitter at PinstarLisa, Instagram and Pinterest, PinstarLisa there as well. I will check your comments and connect with you. I promise you I will. someone was asking me the other day, who someone was on one of my channels, one of my social media channels, and I didn't know, but I knew that they had come through. I didn't know immediately, but upon further checking, I knew that they had come through the show. So I said, yay, that's one of the great Game Changers followers. So glad that you are following me there on social media. So glad that you are connecting. So thank you for your continued support. Game Changers, we are live, and so are you. When you call 404-355-8699, or you can call 866-923-2860. Well, let's get started, guys. You know, our first guest is a game changer in her own right. Really, she is. All game changers are. But we all know the scripture, I have come that you may have life to the full. That's from John 10:10. And for our first guest, that verse isn't merely a comfort or a pick-me-up. It's a decree. It's a mantra for her life. And it is the very thing that has turned her darkest days into a light that is too bright not to share. Just 4 years ago, her father died tragically and unexpectedly, sending her into a dark world of grief. An invitation to serve as a music minister in her church was the beginning of her healing and led to the genesis of her first album, I Made It Through. Primarily an album of restoration songs, it soon caught the attention of music industry heavyweights, leading to performance opportunities with Michael W. Smith, Jason Crabb, Sanctus Real, plus multiple award-winning producer Ed Cash, who decided to jump on board for her sophomore record released in spring of 2015. So it is aptly titled, We Will Rise. It is a continuation of a journey of healing from surviving to thriving. That's what Game Changers do. You know that, right? The project took on a very clear direction, she says. I knew I made it through, but it was time for more. It was just a stepping stone. Rising above is the true message. Now, with that, great listeners, I would like to give a very warm welcome to Natasha Owens. Welcome, Natasha.
Hey, Lisa. Thank you for having me.
Oh, my sincere pleasure. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Wow, I've checked out. So yes. Now, Natasha, your path to this successful music career has not been easy or altogether rosy. It's paved with some tragedy, as your short bio speaks of. Tell us about some of it that maybe inspired you to sing. I understand, you know, even from your bio that you lost your father to tragedy. Tell us about some of that.
Well, he was cleaning his guns and was just dealing with a very dangerous gun, and there was a bullet in the chamber, and it went off and hit him in the heart. So 60 seconds later, he was gone, and life as I knew it, I felt, was gone. And I questioned why. I got very angry at God when I didn't get the answer to my why question. And that's a very dangerous question, because 9 times out of 10, you're never going to get the answer. You have to ask, what do I need to learn and who do I need to help, but never why. And I down-spiraled because of the things that I spoke. I was angry, and I down-spiraled into a depression. And was pretty deep in that depression when my pastor called and asked me to be the music minister. And I laughed at him because I said, how can I motivate people and tell them how great God is when I don't feel like he's great right now? And he kept calling, and he finally, the last time he called was on the day I was already going down a suicidal road in my mind.
Wow.
And he said, I feel like that God always gives you a way out, and I feel like this is your last out. And God knew exactly what I needed to hear that day, and I accepted it. And it was the beginning of my restoration. It took me years to dig out of that hole, but from that point forward, I didn't go backwards, because I would focus on the music for that week, and even though I couldn't open up my Bible, I wasn't to the place where I could pray or open up my Bible, but I would listen to a restoration song for the week, and I was out of bed within 2 minutes. So I used
that music
until I could get stronger.
That's so good. Tell us again what you said. I think that's important about never asking why, but ask what. Tell us that again.
I have learned on this side of the trial to ask, what do I need to learn and who do I need to help? Because so many times we make it through or we don't make it through, or we say, thank God until next time, but we never take what we've learned and help somebody else down the same road. And
that's,
I think
so
that's
good.
How we get our true healing is by helping
that's
others.
That's so good. That's so good. That's it right there, Natasha. If we could get out of the way, get out of ourselves, and ask, what do I need to learn or who do I need to help? Wow. And then sometimes we feel like we're at the end of that learning or we can't help anymore. And I think that's when that depression steps in or that kind of just emptiness steps in. But, you know, God is so faithful. He has those things called gifts like yours that to even rescue us at those times. That's such a beautiful story. And so you dealt with the depression, and the music was the answer to bringing you out. Was there an instantaneous turnaround there, or a hit with your first project or something? What was the turnaround there with the music?
With the music, or actually the turning point for my depression?
Yes, the turning point for your
depression. For the depression. Well, I saw little turning points here and there the moment I started playing the music and getting out of bed and so forth. Where it all started was I had gotten through the trial, and I was in a much better place. And I live here in Texas, and it was hot, and it was in the summertime. And I remember the sun beating down, and I was watching my two boys. I have two teenage boys, and God just spoke to me, and he said, you cannot die looking back at what you've lost. You have to live for what you have left, and those boys are what you have left. And
amen.
I remember smiling for the first time in years and feeling that joy back in my soul. I just felt numbness up into that point. And that feeling was so addictive that I said a prayer that day, and I told God, so many people who are going through trials do not feel this feeling, and I will go wherever you want me to go and do whatever you want me to do. I just want to get to everyone that is going through something faith-shaking so that they feel this feeling. And it started within days after that.
Wow, that's so good. Now, what project catapulted you to sing with some of these greats mentioned in your bio, and how have those experiences impacted your career and your outlook now? I mean, that must have been just like a 180 to go from where you were to sing with Michael W. Smith and Jason Crabb and the likes. Tell us about that.
Everything was so backwards in my restoration, which I can only say that it was God. It wasn't me. My music fell in the hands of this big producer in New York that, you know, was all the rock, 80s rock bands, and Billy Joel's manager. And he called me one day and said, I got a hold of your music and I feel something, but I don't know if I can help you. And his dad was dying of cancer. My songs just started playing on his phone 6 weeks later. And he called me on Father's Day and said, I feel like God wants me to help you. And so 3 weeks later, he calls and says, do you want to open for Michael W. Smith? Which is completely backwards for that to be my first concert. And
oh,
I was
goodness.
So overwhelmed. And I said, no, I've never sang these songs live. I don't have a band. And he said, we'll just pray about it. And he said, it's October 3rd, and I about passed out. That's my dad's birthday. So
oh, my goodness.
I knew that God was telling me, you know, just jump out in faith, be prepared, but I'll catch you and do the rest. And he did. And it happened so quickly that I felt like I was a kindergartner running with a bunch of college professors, but I was expected to know what they knew. at least by the crowd and in the professional world. And I was so overwhelmed, and I was on tour with Jason Crabb, and I about broke down one day, and I said, I'm just so, I deal with anxiety, and I'm so overwhelmed. And he said, Tosh, God has called you, and God never calls the equipped, but he will equip who he calls, and so just rest in that. And from then on, I've just repeated those words over and over and over, and God has gotten me from one step to the next, and I've been blessed to be able to be out there with some incredible people who have guided me and given me direction and training. It's been a training ground.
That's great. I love that. You know, that's the God story. That's the faith story. That's the miracles of God. I love it. Well, it sounds like you found a connection with the masses through your music, I mean, which really is the magic of music. Once you got out there and the Lord started to turn around and your music not only ministered to you, I believe, it started to minister to others. Tell us about some of the stories that have been coming through from others because of your music.
Well, I really thought that it was just going to be catered towards grief, and it really... The stages of grief, people walk through the same steps when they go through something that's anything that's faith-shaking. And there's a lot of hurt out there. I had no idea, living in my little bubble here in Texas, how much hurt. And we had one guy come one day, and he was planning on committing suicide while his family went to the concert. And he was going to tell them goodbye in his own way before they went to left for the concert. Well, they got stuck in traffic and had to go straight there, and he was pretty mad because he had to come up there. And they said, why don't you just stay for 5 minutes? And he ended up staying the entire time, and he sat with tears in his eyes, and he said, this is what I'm feeling real. He said, God has given me a second chance today because I was planning on ending it today.
Wow.
And we sit back, as tough as it is for us to be on the road. It's tough. It's a tough life. I sat back with tears in my eyes and said, this is why we do what we do. This is why we do it. If we save one, it's worth it.
Yes, yes, that is so
good. We've had multiple stories like that throughout the years. It's just every time you feel weak, you can't go on. God puts it into perspective really quick and brings us in contact with somebody that makes us sit back and say that.
Mm-hmm. That's so good, Tasha. Now, what's been the most successful project or single, and why do you think so?
Well, we've been building a foundation out there with radio with these singles on this new album. We released the first five in an EP project a year ago because our producer was just too swamped to finish the project, and we just released the We Will Rise, which is the first five plus five more. And every song has just chipped away a little bit further and a little bit further. We Will Rise broke through a couple months ago. And I Am Loved is coming through and doing better than any of them. And I think in today's society with so much negativity, they just need to be reminded that one kind word can change the way that they feel about themselves and their life, and that they just need to know that they're loved. And
wow.
I think that it's resonating with people in today's society, and I think that's why it's doing so well.
And you said you're in Texas now. What part of Texas are you in?
We're in Dallas.
Okay, so you're not affected at all by Hurricane Harvey?
We haven't been affected at all. We've had family and friends that have been affected and still are affected. My husband's uncle live down in Beaumont, and they've been stuck at the hospital with no water. He was rushed to the hospital earlier this week. So they're all having to rebuild as we speak. And I'm glad you mentioned Hurricane Harvey because, you know, being here in Texas, I mean, I'm a Texan. That's my people. And it's been heartbreaking to see, and even the people fleeing up to Dallas to hear their stories. And we've decided this week that with the We Will Rise project, any sales between now and the end of the year, we're donating to Hurricane Harvey to help.
Oh, God bless you. That's wonderful. Well, what do you want the listening audience to know about the project or about Natasha Owens or about anything today?
Well, I guess not so much about me. I just want people to know that they're loved, and they may feel like that they're alone, but God will never leave them. He is putting that promise into the Bible. I read a thing the other day that said there are 365 verses that talk about he will never leave you and to do not fear. And I laughed. I need to see if that is for sure correct and the truth, but I thought 365 verses, it's so perfect. God mentalities like me that I needed to be reminded every single day to not fear and that he's with us. And
amen.
If you're going through something, you know, start finding some verses that deal with the emotion that you're dealing with. Write them down on a piece of paper. Write them down in your arm and constantly pour positive. It's a battlefield of the mind, anything you're going through. And if you win that battle, you've won it.
Amen.
So, yeah, so just know that on a project standpoint, this We Will Rise just came out. We're about to start tour with an artist by the name of Carmen, if you're familiar with him back from the 90s.
Yes, I love Carmen. I haven't heard from him in a while. I used to watch him all the time on TBN.
Yeah. Me and him are going out on tour in the month of October. So, you know, check out We Will Rise and just know that when you purchase that album that it's going to help the people in South Texas.
That's so cool. Now, you weren't really aspiring. Your gifts kind of found you, as the Bible says. Your gifts will make room for you. They will overtake you. But what do you have to say to aspiring artists or aspiring young Christian artists? Or now that you've been in the business for a while, what would you share with others?
You know, it's a very tough industry, and it's filled with industry people and not so much ministry. I'm so much ministry that I have a hard time sometimes because I want everybody to be ministry or to think like that. Just know it's hard, but when God has placed the calling up on your life, it will happen. And our job as Christian artists isn't so much when we hit that stage. Yes, it's a concert. Yes, it's a performance. But our job is to be able to connect in a way to where they feel and hear God and not necessarily us. And that's how you need to rate your performance. And it doesn't matter how many no's you get. If God's in it, it will all work out in the end. And you just need to rest in that and just pray that God equips you and gives you everything you need for every step of the journey.
I love it. And I especially love when God has placed a call upon your life, it will happen. I've heard that from so many game changers and so many believers, and I so believe it to be true. There is nothing that can come between the will of God for your life, and especially when he has called you to a thing. It will find you, and you will get to it. If you keep your mind on him, your focus on him, your faith on him, and your mind on what he has called you to do, it will definitely happen. Well, God bless you for spending this time with us today. Welcome to the Game Changers family.
Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to tell my story. I really appreciate it.
My sincere pleasure. Rick, our engineer, found some of I Am Love on YouTube, so we're going to play a little bit of it as we go to break. But thank you again for your time, and take care of yourself.
Thank you, Lisa.
We'll see ya. All right, Rick, take us to break and let us hear some of I Am Love.
Daughter of Destiny is what God calls the dynamic woman of God, Dr. Dee Greathouse.
Let me tell you something. My life is anything but normal. When the Father and the Son are at the helm of it, and my best friend, the Holy Spirit, is guiding me every step of the way.
Dr. Greathouse's uncommon journey of life has led her to succeed, survive, and accept God's fresh breath of life into her destiny and the lives of everyone she touches through the prophetic gospel and teachings of Dee Greathouse Ministries International.
When Jesus came to me in a vision and we were on the mountaintop, he said something to me that has resounded in my spirit for years. And he simply said this, "I have blessed you so that you can bless many."
Dr. Greathouse will empower you to walk in the purpose God has for you. Now is your time to experience God's miracles taught in Dr. Greathouse's personalized Gold Faith Package. You'll receive Dr. Greathouse's inspiring CD message, Faith, the Antidote.
I want to talk to you for a moment about the supernatural faith, which is a gift of God.
Learn how the gift of faith given to Dr. Greathouse gave her a personal testimony and an amazing healing from illness. Your healing will begin too as you read line by line of how she was able to forgive and minister after an unimaginable tragedy. She shares it all in her pages of her highly acclaimed book, What About Me? And from Dr. Greathouse's private vault, you'll also receive 1 gram of fine gold to remind you, as God reminded Haggai, silver and gold are his, and with it, he grants the great gift of peace. Get the entire Gold Faith Package today for your faith gift of $149.99 or for a gift of $14.99. Receive either the What About Me book or the CD message, Faith, the Antidote. Call 855-334-7316 or log on to dgreathouseministries.com for the Gold Faith Package today. That's 855-334-7316 or log on to dgreathouseministries.com today.
Do you need someone with solid, expert communications experience to write your copy or your next press release? Then you need PennStar Communications. Let PennStar communicate your greatest potential with clear copy written for your business and marketing needs. Whether it's your next event or next campaign, PennStar Communications can write that for you. Visit PennStar.org or call 404-828-0287 today.
Yes,
he made a way. He's making a way for all of us, guys. Thanks so much for listening today. Hope you enjoyed our first guest, Natasha Owens. I certainly did. Superb spirit, superb artist. Hope you're going to check her out at natashaowensmusic.com. Rick played a portion of her single, I Am Love. She's getting ready to go on tour again with the great artist Carmen. She's been hanging out with some greats, and she is a great in her own right. Please know that all donations for that album, for that single, I Am Loved, are going to the victims, the people suffering there in Houston from the Hurricane Harvey devastation there. So that's very wonderful of her. Giving back is what it's all about, guys. Well, let's get ready for our next guest. You know, they are game changers, too. Our next guest's real life story will encourage any heart that's ever been broken. They are a husband and wife duo who released their self-titled national debut album in March, which was quickly followed by just released deluxe edition, both being Discovery House Music. It features 11 songs birthed from a difficult and raw time in their lives, including a separation, divorce, and remarriage to each other. I think that is enough right there just to get us started with the husband and wife duo out of the dust. Welcome to Game Changers with Lisa Faulkner, Chris and Stephanie Teague.
Hey, how you doing?
I am doing well. How are you two?
We're doing well. We're actually relaxing now after a long summer of touring. So
Long summer of touring sounds nice, but relaxing sounds good as well. Now, you guys, you know the bit about being divorced and married again to each other, nonetheless, stops people dead in their tracks. So we have to start with that. I mean, now, Chris, I understand you were the problem, but I'm going to let you
explain.
I'm kidding, Chris. I'm kidding. You have a sense of humor, right?
Absolutely.
But how did divorce happen? Seriously, I know it was really nothing to kid about. It was a slow spiral, as I understand from your bios. But how did divorce happen, and how did you know you had made a mistake divorcing one another? What brought you back together? I mean, I'm asking a lot of questions, and I'm expecting for you to give it to me in the short amount of time. But give us the short story.
Sure, and I'll encourage Stephanie to jump in too. But we met really young, and I think because of that, you know, we got married young as well, and just in our naivety, in our youth, we just weren't seeking people that that were older and wiser than us to help us. And I feel like we brought different expectations to the marriage very early on. Stephanie came from a very beautiful, you know, loving and you know, two parents in the home full time, and my mom and I were all each other had. So you know, there's a lot to unpack there, but we just didn't have a lot of the same expectations, and I would be out until 2-3 in the morning sometimes with friends, and a wedge began to be driven in our marriage that way, just from not really feeling fulfilled. I think I'd put marriage on a pedestal, and as an idol that really let me down. And I got into drugs, not as a result of that, but just out of, you know, some curiosity. And while I was in college, I started doubting the Lord as well, and all of that was done in secrecy. The drugs, the doubt, this was all something that I kept from everybody, including Stephanie. And you want to talk about, you know, driving a wedge between the two of us? It really, really did. And we were worship leaders, you know, not in full-time capacity, but as volunteers and in staff capacity. So I got to the point where I'm on stage, you know, leading worship, drawing people to the heart of God, and I didn't believe any of it. And I was, you know, out partying the night before, and it was just completely destroying me, and it was destroying our marriage.
So
that had to come to a head. So really, I sat Stephanie down one night, and I told her, I don't believe in God anymore, and I don't want to be married anymore.
Mm. Wow, Stephanie. Were you none the wiser as he was struggling, as Chris was struggling with all of this, or were you just trying to hold on to your prayers and your faith, thinking it would turn around?
Well, I knew nothing until he sat me down that night. And, you know, you look back, you see the warning signs or the little red flags. But from that night, my world, as I knew it, was completely ripped out from under me. And I fought for our marriage for a while. The people in our lives, our family, our church, they really rallied around us and prayed for us, and they pursued Chris, but nothing was changing his mind. So he filed for divorce, and it was final within a few months after everything happened.
Wow. But obviously that was not a good decision for either of you. And how did you turn back to each other in such a short amount of time?
It was a short amount of time. I think it surprised a lot of people, including us. I remember telling Stephanie, even if I come back to the Lord someday, I don't see us being together. Boy, that must have felt really good for her to hear that. I'm kidding. Had to have just driven a knife, but that was how I felt. I didn't want to give any false hope, and so you know, I just drove myself into the ground. You know, I'd lived in secret for so long. And this was an opportunity for me to finally be free, and that was how I thought it would be. And I created an idol out of that freedom. You know, I just continued chasing idol after idol, none truly satisfying. And this newfound freedom was exactly the same way. I was in control of my life for the first time, or at least it would seem so. I say this a lot, but, you know, as I left, I wanted freedom, but I wanted freedom to sin. I wanted freedom to do these destructive behaviors, and that's not freedom. You know, that's
right.
It's just slavery. So
the
chains got heavier. I built up more walls around myself, and it all just caved in, back in on itself. My life just sort of imploded within 6 months, and I just had to lay myself. I was waking up in cold sweats. I was anxious. You know, I couldn't deal with, you know, a lot of the guilt of all the selfishness that I had, that I had been pursuing, and all the pain that I'd caused. So I, even though I left with doubt, intellectual doubt, God found me through my heart and through that brokenness. He moved in and became real to me for the first time in years. And we were talking and praying, and he shows up, so I can't deny him anymore. And even though I walked away from Stephanie during that sweet, sweet season of reacquainting myself with God, and we were just growing so deep, he started whispering and then telling and then shouting to me to pursue Stephanie again.
Wow, your story is so poignant. Just a really, really beautiful story. Well, where did the music come in? Did you always sing together?
We always sang doing worship together, but we never wrote our own songs together. Chris did that a little on his own. But I was never involved in that. So for us...
Yes, because Chris did say you were worship leaders.
Yeah. So we led for some college group and youth. And so once we fast forward a little bit from where Chris left off, once we decided to move forward and get married again, which was a miracle in and of itself.
Stephanie had to... process through a lot of forgiveness. We went to marriage counseling.
We
sought wisdom for the first time in our in our, you know, married or adult lives. You know, we were seeking wisdom from others. And
oh yeah, I could talk to you for another half hour about my side of the story.
I was going to say, Stephanie warrants an interview in her own of her own to not only, you know, a show, but to women, to relationships.
Yeah.
That's a ministry in itself, really, that could help others heal, that could help others forgive, that could help, you know, that's a ministry in itself, really, really. But that's love like God loves. So that's good. Go ahead.
Yeah, so music came up after we were remarried. Chris, maybe that same year, I guess we ended up going to a GMA Immerse conference here in Nashville, just kind of for fun. We thought, hey, this will be fun. There was a worship track, and I wanted to do that, and there was also an artist track. And we ended up like, hey, we're going to both be there. Why don't we just try and do the duo competition? Just, you know, we'll work something up. So kind of on a whim, we did, and we kept making it further and further in the competition and ended up in the finals. And I was terrified because I'd never performed in music that way. You know, worship is a totally different thing than being on stage and performing. And even though I felt like we were terrible, there was, as soon as we were done, we had a chance for about 30 seconds to quickly share our story. And when we were done, I had a woman come running up to me bawling because of what she was going through with her husband. And that was really the moment when we felt like, okay, we have this story we feel responsible to tell. And if music is something that we feel God leading us towards together, that's a platform that we can use to share the story and to share this hope and redemption that we all have in Jesus.
Amen. That's a get back, Stephanie. That's a stand back and be silent, what you just said. Yeah. That's a stand back and just be silent. Who are some of your influences? I mean, what you just said, I mean, I guess that's the major influence, but I think your music really just comes from your experience, not so much influenced by anything or anyone else. Is that
Absolutely.
True?
We try, so as far as like the song content, you know, our story is, It's a big part of our story, but we try not to, like, pigeonhole our songs in such a way that, you know, not everybody goes through what we go through, so we try to translate what we went through in a way that people can relate to. And so there are themes of joy and, you know, just some celebration and love, but there's also just a really deep themes of surrender and pain and heartache, but hope in the midst of that and not casting aside suffering or wishing it away, you know, that suffering has a purpose. It's one of the deepest ways that we meet God is when we allow him to engage us in our suffering and allow him to reveal himself through that.
It is. I mean, both of your stories, both of your models before human, you know, human life, your humanity is so, it really is inspiring. Your story, Chris, I mean, you admit that you were struggling with believing in God, even giving up on him. So I'm sure that there are a lot of people out there, that's not an easy thing to admit. And even living a Christian life and turning away from the faith, that's not something people want to easily admit. But I would venture to say that there are a lot of Christians that struggle the same way. Do you have the opportunity to speak to others about that part of your faith walk?
Sure, I do. And we get I don't get a lot of people that come to me with their questions. Normally we see the other side of it, you know, one partner or one family member is lost or is questioning, and, you know, we get that side of it. But I just want this huge banner over our ministry and just over the church, the church as a whole, that we need to feel safe. You know, we are each other's greatest asset as the body of Christ, and to feel like our doubt somehow makes us less, or to feel like we're not normal because we're doubting God is just absurd. You know, it's if someone is doubting, you are not alone. Scripture meets you there. There's questioning within the pages of our Bible. So we do try to encourage folks that way and try to, I guess, maybe get them to pass the message on.
Yeah, and I think a big point, too, that we stress is don't do it alone. You know, don't,
yeah.
don't try to find the answers on your own. Involve people who are older and wiser than you to help you work through those doubts.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's the trick of the enemy when you do suffer alone. As long as the enemy can keep you alone in your sin or suffering alone, then he has the upper hand. Then there's no healing. There's no, you know, you're not delivered that way. But once you expose it, once you bring it out, then there is healing. There is restoration. You do get the answers you need. So you are exactly correct. That is the perfect message. Who are you singing to? I think we've answered that maybe. You're singing to those like yourself, those who have come through similar struggles, or maybe you're just singing to the masses. Who are you singing to?
Stephanie's pointing at me. My heart is to sing to the church. There are so many artists in Nashville. I think it was C.S. Lewis who said that some of us sing to the light and some of us turn around and sing about the light. And I think there's a lot of artists in Nashville that wouldn't categorize themselves as Christians, but they are Christian. You know, so we feel a burden to speak to the church and to edify and admonish and encourage and try to speak to people who are going through things like what we went through. Yes, we want to celebrate with those who have walked through it, and we hear those stories a lot. But so much more often we hear the stories of people who are in the middle of it. So to be able, or who, you know, are at the very beginning stages of it, so we want to speak and sing and write to the body in a way that lets them know that they're not alone and that there is hope to be found.
Hallelujah, that's the truth. So Out of the Dust, is that your first project?
Yeah, well, sort of.
Our first full-length project, yeah. We've done a couple of shorter EPs, but it's our first full-length.
All right. What's your favorite on the project, or what's doing the best? Or
I think the song that we hear that resonates most with people is our single, All That I'm Made For, and that was one that we wrote after coming back from Kenya. We were able to go serve at an orphanage for a couple of weeks several years ago, and coming back to America and everything that we have here, it was hard to acclimate back to having so much after living with these orphans who have nothing. And so we wrote this song as a prayer, really as an anthem of asking the Lord to wake us up and to help us be all that he created us to be, because we know we're not meant to just live this day in, day out, daily grind. Mm-hmm. You know, just we know that God has something more for us.
And it took us going to Kenya. It took us going to Kenya to feel that feeling. So we wanted to try and bring that back and try to help wake people up to see the greatness of
people. Oh, sometimes it just takes... It takes a lot for most of us, Chris. Sometimes it takes a lifetime for most of us to really know what Stephanie said. We're all just created for sometimes so much more than we pour into this life. But we have it in us. God has gifted us, and we are able. Well, I certainly appreciate you. What do you want to share with the listening audience today beyond what we have already discussed, or maybe just more of what we've discussed?
Well, just more in line with what we said before. We felt, as far as suffering and how suffering can truly produce change, not everybody's going through suffering right now. But, you know, it took, like I said before, it took us going all the way to Kenya and having our hearts just completely devastated to feel like, you know, there was more And I say this a lot from stage before we sing this song. Waking up is hard. Waking up isn't easy. I don't know many people that, you know, enjoy hearing that alarm bell in the morning. It's a tough process to ask God, what do you really want me to do? You know, God, wake me up. It change isn't easy. But you know, through that really heartbreaking suffering that we experienced with those orphans, it was a beautiful experience. But God produces things out of the midst of our suffering, and Stephanie can attest to that, and I can, and all the people that we walk in community with have this common theme of seeing beauty come from suffering and growth come from suffering. And that's where
I'm smiling, because that's where our name comes
our
from.
Our name comes from, yeah.
Out of the dust.
Yes, that's what I was thinking. That's so good. Yeah. All right. Well, I certainly appreciate you all. Welcome to the Game Changers family.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
Of course. Do you have children?
We do.
We do. We have two. We have a 4-year-old son named Asher and a 2-year-old little girl named Nora. So they are quiet right now because they're with grandparents in the other room. Otherwise, you'll hear the crazy that our house is. It's a wonderful crazy, but it's loud most of the time.
I can only imagine. Well, God bless you. We've got a little bit of your single. Let's see, which one do we have, Rick? We have All That I'm Made For, the one that we discussed. So we will play it as we let you bid you all goodbye for this evening. But again, welcome to the Game Changers family, and thank you so much for your time today.
Thank you, Lisa, so much. We're honored to be a part of this.
My sincere pleasure. Take care of yourselves.
Thank you.
All right.
Bye-bye.
All right,
bye.
Rick, play us to break. And I will be right back, guys, so don't go anywhere. We're going to play a little bit of their song, and we will be right back to close the hour.
Foolish pride, it was all about me, all about me, all about me. Oh, oh, I give my life away and fall upon your mercy and your grace. You're all that I need, all that I need, all that I need.
The Sankofa Media Group is a mass media company that creates socially responsible, informative, and entertaining content that reaches audiences all over the world. Sankofa Media's leading-edge technology and know-how develops winners into who they were created to be. Timely radio and talent like Blog Talk Radio's Abiding the Tripartite.
God tells us in His Word we can have what we say, but we are always saying what we have. You must believe to the point of expectation, and you shall receive.
And Game Changers with Lisa Faulkner.
I want to talk to the Game Changers. I want to talk to the ones who the game was changed on, but yet they triumphed. I want to talk to the people who provide a platform for others to change the game for themselves.
Sankofa publishes messages of love, hope, and redemption that connect with us where we need it the most.
The book, What About Me, is a story of the kind of faith and courage that engages the reader to reflect personally and spiritually, especially in these uncertain times of today. It's a great thought-provoking page-turner.
If you're ready to step out of the boat and join the Sankofa Media Group in showcasing your God-given gifts and talents, contact us today at 855-334-7316. That's 855-334-7316.
All that I know is I'm fine.
Well, guys, that brings us to another great hour. You know, when we come to the end of these Game Changers hours, I don't know if you're not inspired. I don't know what will inspire you. Just amazing, amazing stories. And they normally get amazing just after the darkness, just after the tragedy, you know. Our first story from Natasha Owens, just after losing her dad, you know, in such a tragic way, and fighting depression and questioning God and just not wanting to go on anymore, fighting depression and just thinking bad thoughts. But, you know, God found her in those deep, dark times and just turned things around for her in just the most miraculous ways. And look at how she's using her gifts all around the globe right now to influence others' lives and make a difference in just the most insane ways, just wonderfully insane ways. And out of the dust, oh my gosh, that story, that couple, just the dichotomy of their ways, just the difference in their approach and their thoughts, the miracle of just the forgiveness in Stephanie and Chris and his transparency and honesty and the way that he comes forth and with all of his, you know, struggles and presents them just for others to understand that it's okay. You know, it's okay, and there's a way out, and there's a better way. Wow, guys. And look at them now, just loving each other the way that they were intended to. I love it. I love it. I love it. Check them out, Out of the Dust. Check out Natasha Owens. I got to go. I will talk to you in 6:23. That's 6 days and 23 hours. Until then, do your best.
Thank you for listening to Game Changers with Lisa Faulkner. For more details about anything discussed on this program, go online to www.penstar.org. That's PENSTAR.org. Be sure to follow Lisa on social media. And be sure to subscribe to the Game Changers with Lisa Faulkner podcast on iHeartRadio and iTunes.